Okay, hello everyone. Good morning everyone. Namaste. So I hope everyone is in. Right. So some. Yes, we'll wait for 2 minutes. We'll wait for 2 minutes and then we'll start with this session. I hope this phone is audible. Okay, so shall we go on? We'll go ahead. Okay, without wasting my time. So first of all, I'll introduce myself. I'm Sachin Kumboje. I basically lead OPEC Startup Accelerator as a CEO. So right now we do have industry associations. We do have institution associations so that we can create this startup ecosystem. And right from last 4 years, we have been working in this startup ecosystem as a ecosystem enabler. I hope I'm audible. Just reply whether am I audible. Just reply yes or no. Am I audible? Yes. Okay. Thank you, Mohit sir. Thank you, Abhijit sir. So we'll go ahead. So right from last 4 years, we are working with this OPEX as a startup accelerator. So fortunately, we are the first and only startup accelerator working in Western Maharashtra. We have been recognized from Government of India, Startup India, Invest India Federation as official startup accelerator. We are working with institutions to set up their startup centers. We are working with technical institutions to set up their incubation centers, to activate their incubation centers, startup centers, be it in engineering institution, be it in management institution, or be it in any kind of technical institutions, even in pharmacy institutions. Okay, so this session is basically organized in view so that we can connect with maximum institutions, we can connect with maximum faculty who are taking care of all the startup related activities in your own campuses. So there are some faculties, there are some the professors who are working hard for innovation, working hard for innovative products, working hard so that they can translate their student innovation into a commercial product. But during this entire journey, where the things basically went wrong is commercialization of any kind of commercialization, be it from idea to a product. So whenever we consider this entire journey of startup, maximum challenges where we focus is technology commercialization. So as a professor, as a faculty, as a institutions, you are extremely good in innovation, you are extremely good in product, you are extremely good in technology. But when it comes to startup, when it comes to business, what matters a lot is business model. What matters a lot is customer behavior. What matters a lot is its commercialization. So this is how we come in picture. So where we guide, we mentor these student startups, and eventually we bring their products, their innovation into a commercially viable product as a startup. So during this entire whole journey, even in day one, we have seen the identify a problem, a burning problem, what could be the pain points of the customer. On day two, you have seen idea validation, mainly how to validate idea, what are those factors which will basically influence your idea validation. So I'm thankful to both the speakers. I'm thankful to Professor Sonamne sir. I'm thankful to Professor Dodmise sir for identifying this as one of the better opportunity for all the institutions and making their associations in a better way with this particular 3 days FDP. So today I'll be discussing with you two things. First is market research and second one is business model canvas. So we'll divide this both part in two different segments. So first we'll discuss about market research. Now, up till now, as right now you have validated, you have identified a burning problem of customer. You right now you have identified the pain points of the customer. Then whenever you are generating any kind of idea, any kind of solution, any kind of product, then eventually on day two you have learned how to validate this idea. Now next is, before you actually commercialize your product, before you actually commercialize your idea, next part which comes in picture is market research or market survey. Okay, now to analyze this or to discuss this market research, I have some very good case studies for you, where we can take the help of all these case studies so that we can understand all this market survey and market research in a better way. So here we are going to discuss different case studies. Like the first is Byju's case studies. We are going to discuss. Next is Pampers or any kind of diapers. Or next is Nexa, Maruti Suzuki Nexa. Even that we are going to study a case study of Nexa. The next we are going to study is the case study of Sensodyne. You must have seen the advertisements of Sensodyne. Next we are going to see the case study of Britannia, a product which they wanted to bring in, but unfortunately because of this market research they decided not to bring that particular product. So all these case studies we are going to see in the first part, market research, and in the second part, wherein for business model canvas we are going to see case studies of Zomato or Swiggy or Paytm. We are going to have a discussion on their business models. So let us start with this first market research. So here, as you can see here, a simple explanatory diagram with the help of which I'll be going to discuss you all the essentials of market research. So in center we have this market research and the factors which compose it, or factors which we need to take in or we need to take into account. That is the four things or four factors. First is of course your customer, then your market, then your pricing, and then your competitor. So let us first focus on the customer. So whenever we consider this innovation, or whenever we consider this idea, be it in a product stage, be it in a service stage, what matters a lot is customer. So there are multiple things which we need to understand as far as customer is concerned. First, identify who is your customer. Then let me tell you a small case study. Eventually, maybe during January and February, we were executing a tech startup ideathon, and where we started visiting multiple institutions so that we can connect with the students and get their ideas. Now, important and exciting thing to see here is all these students, majority from engineering institutions, from management institutions. So all these institutions, all these students, they came up with their presentation, a quick presentation, and they had very excellent ideas. They had very excellent innovation, be it in service sector, be it in product sector. But when it comes to their business model presentation, they were completely failure. Almost 90% students, they were not understanding who is my customer. So that's the essential point which you all need to understand is who is my customer. So let's take an example of, say for example, you can just take an example of diapers. You consider any company, you consider Pampers, you consider Mammy Poco Pants, you consider any brand of diapers, even on day one. Sonavne sir has even given insights on the this particular example, where we can consider this example to identify customer. Now in case of this, who is my customer? If suppose I'm coming with some innovative diapers, if suppose I'm coming with a brand through which I'm selling these diapers, then no doubt here you have to understand who is my customer and who is my consumer. So ideally my consumer is not the one who is paying to me. In this case, my consumer is that little baby, that particular, in that case, kids. So these babies are basically consumers, where whatever things or whatever products I'm checking in or coming in or selling, that will be ultimately consumed by that baby. But for that particular product, that baby is not paying the price or that particular fees for that product. Now, here, who comes in picture? The actual customer, maybe his or her parents. So ideally, his mom or his dad. These parents are basically customer in this case. So now that I have identified who is my customer, then I can switch over to my marketing strategies. So for example, if suppose I am marketing all these products, if suppose right now I am doing a marketing campaign for these diapers, then for example, in that case, social media campaigns. So whenever I'll be having the social media campaign for marketing these diapers, then I have to target such audience. Or for example, you can consider an age group of 25 to 40. So these are the age of parents who basically wish to buy a baby diapers. So that's the age. See, you cannot target a person or a customer who is below 25 age or who is more than 40, in that case more than 50. So your product is basically targeting only those customers with their age group. Secondly, here, as far as marketing campaign is considered, you will make or you will run this campaign in tier 1, tier 2, tier 3 cities only, because the awareness or the usage of your product as a diaper will not be there or in a negligible amount will be there in tier 4 cities. So you are not catering to tier 4 cities or tier 4 towns in that case. So here your target market and your target customer, that you have to identify. You have to identify who is customer and who is consumer. Second example, we can take a case study of Byju's. Now Byju's is again, as far as this is a edutech startup, they have some innovations in their learning model. Now in case of Byju's, this is again very exciting case study. Who is your customer? Who is your consumer? Who is your influencer? And who is your facilitator? So ideally, in this case, when we see the example or the case study of Byju's, in this case, no doubt consumer is that kid or that student who is wish or who wants to have these learning models in his tab, right? So here consumer is that kid or that student. He is not paying the amount for your Byju's subscription. This means that kid or that student is not your customer, he is your consumer. Second, then who is your customer? Customer is the one who is paying your subscription fees. In that case, the parent, or more precisely, a father. In this case, his classmate who basically uses this Byju's, he will act as an influencer, right? Because he is using, or because my classmate is using Byju's, because my classmate has that Byju's tab, then I can ask or then I can request my parents to buy the same thing for me. This is how kids do. So in that case, your neighbor or that neighbor kid or that classmate, he acts as an influencer to buy this thing. Second, a mom, his mother, that student's mother, she acts as a facilitator who basically channelizes an appeal of your student, of her kid, to his father. So she acts as a facilitator. So in most of the cases, mother, she is in a role of facilitator. And lastly, a father, from his own pocket, he is actually subscribing that Byju's. So ultimately, her father or that kids or student's father is a customer as far as Byju's is concerned. So this is how it goes. So what we understood is you have to identify who is your customer and who is your consumer. Now, when you are bringing some innovation, whenever you are formulating a new product or a new service, what typical problem or what pain point you are solving of your customer? Is it his need or is it his demand? So again, we have to classify customer into two parts: a need-based customer, a want-based customer, right? So, because here we are going to see the pricing as well. So this is again an interesting part where we can see a scenario where you have a product based on your product. So this demand of your customer, whether it is his need or it is want. So let's take one more case study of Nexa. So Nexa, when we see a cars of Maruti Suzuki, suppose I am a customer of Maruti Suzuki right now. Suppose, for example, I own Maruti Suzuki Alto. So the reason why I choose Maruti Suzuki Alto is because I am a customer of Maruti Suzuki from a need based category. It is my need that I should have a car. It is my need. But suppose if I am a customer of Maruti Suzuki with say Nexa Ciaz or Baleno, then I am the same customer of Maruti Suzuki, but from want category. So here you have to identify, you have to classify the need and the want of your customer. That's the reason why Maruti Suzuki have differentiated need based customers in Maruti Suzuki and want based customers in Nexa. Ideally, the marketing strategies will be different. The retention of the customers would be completely different. From the last 16 years, Maruti Suzuki has seen 98% retention of their customers. And that's the reason why Maruti Suzuki is again number one in automobile. So that's the reason. So next is, again, as we have understood, the customer, whether he is consumer or he is a customer. Next is whether it is his need or it is his want. Now, how will you understand all these things? So here comes a part of market survey. So suppose, for example, today I have some product ready with me. Suppose today I have a prototype ready with me. So again, here you have to follow a lean startup. So eventually you might have seen this particular book of Lean Startup. If you have this book, you should read this if you want or if you wish to learn everything about startup, a lean startup. So what Lean Startup states? Lean Startup states build, learn, and then you have to measure, right? So here we can have an example of this Lean Startup. So this is how, I hope everyone can see this. So this is how this lean startup, it plays important role. Now, let's understand this. Right now you have an idea. Right now you have a basic idea about creating something, a basic idea of solving a customer's problem. Now, eventually, whatever idea you have, you build a product for this. So first step in Lean Startup is you have an idea and you build a product. Now, this product is nothing but a prototype. This is not a commercial product. This is here you have to reach a market survey. So this is the stage where you have a market survey. So this is an integral part of market research where you need to understand if you are ready with your prototype, then go on with market survey. Now, how will you have this market survey? Now, for market survey, what you need to have is you have to identify 300 projected customers, or we call them as teaching customer, through which you can get a genuine feedback. Now, you have to take care of these 300 teaching customers or initial projected customers, which are projected only for feedback. So first thing you need to understand here is all 300 customers should be unknown to you. They should be unknown to you. This is not like I have some friends, I have some relatives, I have some classmates, and through which I can give them this prototype for trial and eventually they will give me a genuine feedback. This will not happen. 300 strangers should be there for conducting a market survey. Second, you should not give them for trial your prototype. You should not give them for a trial for free. Whatever pricing you have calculated so that you can achieve your break-even or your return on investment ROIs. So based on your break-even only, you need to understand or you need to give that particular pricing, and whatever 300 strangers which are going to buy from you, you need to understand their customer behavior as well. Why they are paying you, whether your product, whether your prototype, is it solving their problem? Right. For example, right now you have something or some prototype, which may be something like a mask or innovative mask we have seen, or a sanitizer or whatever it is, or any product. So is it solving that customer's problem? If it is solving a customer's problem, then and then only they will pay you. That's the reason you should not give them for free for this trial. So for market survey, first thing, identify 300 strangers and sell it to them. Second, sell it. Don't give them as a free trial. Sell it. Okay. Third, get their genuine feedback, get their data. So this is how the second step of lean startup is here. Product, then measure. Your feedback comes here. Measure, get their data, get their data. Out of 10, what are those essential 10 of 10 points? What are the lacunas or what are those pitfalls? What are those gaps in his customer behavior and your prototype? So here you have to identify, you have to get this entire data so that you can identify the pitfalls. Right now, suppose for example, in feedback, you have given them 10 different points or based on 10 factors, based on 10 parameters, you have framed a feedback form. For example, even we have feedback platforms like SurveyMonkey and all, or SurveySparrow likewise. So here, when you have this 10 parameter survey sheet, you can circulate to these 300 stranger customers or teaching customers. Out of 10 parameters, you will get some 5-star rating to some components, some parameters. You will get three star or 2-star to some points, and you will get probably 1-star for some parameters or some components. Now is the time you have this data. Learn from this data. Learn from those parameters where you have 1-star, where you have 2-star. Based on your customer's feedback, then you can analyze what are those pitfalls, what are those lacunas in your prototype, in your product. So again, you have to ideate. Again, you have to ideate so that you can build a better product. So here comes in picture MVP, minimum viable product. So in order to construct a minimum viable product, you have to get this initial feedback from your teaching customers. I can give you a case study or examples of such startups who have approached their startups or who have came through a lean startup. The first example is Airbnb. So Airbnb, they launched for the first time. It was completely failure. Then they again got this data. They learned something out of it. They learned what are the customer's expectations. Then again, for second time, they launched it in market. Again, it was completely failure. Then again, they learned something from their customer's feedback, their pitfalls, their lacunas, and they worked on their product. They worked on their business model. And now for the third time, whenever they came and relaunched their product, then we can see within a short span of time, Airbnb becomes a unicorn startup. So this is how it works. This is how lean startup works. And this is how market survey, it plays important role in this entire market research. Same is the example of Dropbox. Even Dropbox is a product. Dropbox is a startup which has been successfully drawn through this lean startup. So eventually, this stage of market survey is very critical. If you failed in market research, if you failed in market survey, if you neglected market survey, then don't think about scaling up your business, right? after some time, you might realize that whatever you have constructed, whatever ideas you have constructed, whatever product you have constructed, that is of no use of that customer. So identify who is your customer, identify your market, whether it is tier 1, tier 2, tier 3, tier 4. Identify gender of your customer, identify his age group, identify where is my customer. For example, this is again a case of marketing. So right now, if suppose, take an example of our own startup, which is Make Me Hire. Now, Make Me Hire is basically a recruitment marketplace, and our customer is HR of all these corporates. So this is again what solutions we are giving them, the hiring solutions or recruitment solutions. So for us, who is basically customer? The HR, right? Now, as far as marketing strategy is concerned, as far as marketing channels are concerned, where is my customer located? If suppose I am doing my advertisements, if I am doing my marketing campaigns through some holdings and some local TV campaigns, then probably my customer is not there. If suppose I am doing my advertisement campaign on Instagram or on Facebook or on TikTok, no doubt my customer is not there only. Where is my customer? So my customer, who is HR, he is there on LinkedIn. So ideally, I have to run my marketing campaign on LinkedIn only. No use of Facebook, no use of TikTok, no use of Instagram, no use of TV advertisements or commercials, no use of SEOs, no use of your holdings. I have to concentrate only on LinkedIn. So this is how it works, right? So these are the cases, or this is how you market survey. It plays important role whenever you are building a product. Some few things which you need to understand, that is pricing. How will you decide the pricing? This is the question which probably asked by many of the professionals whenever they started to build their product. So it is as simple as you have to calculate break even of your own product. So let me first share you what is break even cost, or how will you have this break even point of your own startup or your own venture. For example, if suppose I'm building something, suppose I have my app-based startup, and right now my investment is, say, for example, 10 lakh rupees. So today, in May 2020, I have invested 10 lakh rupees for my particular application. Now, here you have to calculate first break-even point. So ideally, your break-even point should be within 1,000 days. So that's how even in management books, you have seen 1,000 days of business survival. So within 1,000 days, you need to recover your initial investment. So right now, my initial investment is 10 lakh rupees. So before 3 years, before this 1,000 days, whatever business I am doing, whatever revenue I am earning, whatever profits I am earning, that should recover, or that should be equal to 10 lakh rupees. So for example, today I have started my work in May 2020, and for example, during September 2020, I am ready to launch. So from September 2020 to September 2021, this is the time where I can make a business of, say, 10 lakh rupees. This means 1.3 years, this is my break-even point. So within one year and 3 months, I have recovered my initial investment. Now, based on your break-even analysis, based on your break-even point, based on your projections of your customers, of your sales, of your revenues, you have to calculate your own pricing. And the important part in framing your pricing is whether you have a competitor for your product or not. So first identify whether whatever product you are bringing in market, you are the only one, or do you have that monopoly? Or again, we can have two different concepts. One is red ocean, one is blue ocean. So ideally, if suppose I'm bringing something which will create, or which will have my monopoly of my own product, I'm the only one who is creating or who is building this particular product. So I'll be the only one in a market. So the positioning will be stronger one. So that we can call it as a blue ocean. You can take various example. For example, best example for blue ocean is Jio. The strategy how Jio played during their launch, they basically or we can call them or classify them as one of the essential theory or essential strategy which Jio comes in through their strategies in market. So we can call them as a blue ocean, where with their strategies, with their marketing, with their products, they are the only one who have their own strategies. Like other red ocean. So red ocean, here you can see n number of players. For example, you can consider even sanitizers. So there was a time whenever we were not at all using sanitizers, but because of this COVID outbreak and all, we started using sanitizers. So new companies came into market, and this entire market has become a red ocean for these products like sanitizers. So this is how it works. So you have to identify whether your product, it falls in the category of blue ocean or red ocean. If you are in blue ocean, try to utilize this opportunity before someone comes in. Those who are Maharashtrians here, I can give you example of Amrut Tulya Chaha. So Amrut Tulya Chaha, when it comes into market, it was into a blue ocean. Everyone wants to taste that particular tea, Amrut Tulya Chaha, or that particular flavor of tea. Then how they started fragmenting, or they started distributing their businesses through a franchise business model. And then we can see n number of outlets of these Amrut Tulya tea centers, right? So by looking this business model, by looking this entire idea and entire concept, few more competitors came in the market. And today what we can see is at each corner of our city, today we have tea stalls of some XYZ Amrut Tulya tea. So this is how a red ocean and blue ocean plays a game here in case of startup. So if you have any product, if you have any prototype, if it is falling in blue ocean, then try to commercialize it as early as possible till the time competitors comes in your picture. If it is in red ocean, then try to make it, what is your USP then? If your product, it is falling in red ocean, already there are few competitors for you. Two things you can do here is, first is see what are those pitfalls, what are those gaps in competitor's business or in competitor's product, and try to make it as a your USP, right? Second is try to integrate your competitors. So there are n number of players in the market who basically collaborate with each other, who basically merge with each other. Even we have seen different startups in e-commerce categories where two competitors, they came together through mergers and acquisitions, and they're doing fantastic. So these are various examples of mergers and acquisitions where even competitor can be your business partner. This can be one of the avenue in that. So this was all about market survey. Next thing which we are going to discuss here is business model canvas. So there are some theories as far as business model canvas are concerned. Now business model, again, essential part of any startup. As I said in the earlier part, that idea is there, innovation is there. Yes, no doubt you are creating a solution for customer's problem, no issues. But startup is all about 20% of innovation and 80% about its execution. So as far as execution is important, the most important part is your business model, how you execute your commercial plans into a business model. So there are again n number of business models, but to share some of the business models, we do have some 8 to 10 different leading business models which are running in our country. The first is transaction model. This can be one of the business model. Transaction model, best example I can give you here is consulting business. Consulting business is basically follows transaction model. Second business model is hourly rate model. Suppose I'm an app developer, I'm a website developer, and whatever clients I have approached for their application development or website development, the quotation which we charge them, it is basically on hourly rate basis. So this is again one more business model. Third is franchise business model. you have seen n number of franchises right now. We have seen an example of Amrut Tulya Chai. So they what they run is franchisee business model. We do have Monginis, we do have Wellness Forever, we do have n number of franchise business models, successful franchise business models. The next is subscription model. Even you have right now examples of your Hotstar, your different Amazon Prime, your Netflix. So these are having the subscription models. Even your telecom operators, they have the same, that is subscription model. That is one of the type of business model. Then you have shared savings. Or for example, here we can take one example of, suppose I have made one machine, I have made one innovation or created one component or a machine. And if suppose the application of this machine is, this basically helps you to drop down your electricity bill. For example, for me, my customer would be an industrialist. Suppose right now his entire per month bill, electricity bill of that manufacturing plant, it comes, say for example, 30,000. But when he uses my component, when he uses my machine in their particular electricity department or electricity components, then that 30,000 or monthly bill of 30,000, it can drops down to 20,000. So each month he is saving 10,000 rupees because of my component. Right now I have two options. Either I can sell my product one time to that particular customer. If he is my one-time customer, then automatically that customer will be locked for me for a longer period of time. So say for next 5 years, next 10 years, he will not come to me to buy the same machine. So again, rather than locking that customer, what we can do is we can create a recurring revenue from the same customer. How we can do this? For example, you should not charge any or a single rupee to that customer, but you can make one agreement with this shared savings model is like, however or whatever you are saving, 50% saved amount will be my revenue. Now in this case, if per month he has saved 10,000, out of which 5,000 will be my revenue. So every month from one customer, I am creating a recurring revenue from that shared savings model. So that can be one of the model. Rather than locking your customer for a longer period of time, try to convert the same customer through a recurring business model, so that whatever or however he is using his services, automatically every month the revenue will comes into your business. Next would be licensing model. Licensing model, you have software licenses, you have some other Microsoft and other licenses. Even for example, if suppose I have drawn a sketch of Motu Patlu, then that could be a sellable model through by selling or by licensing out that Motu Patlu or Shinchan or some cartoons, then even through royalty I can earn something. So that is again a licensing model. Consumable model, even today we have seen all the corporate offices right now, they have this coffee machines or tea making machines. So I will not charge anything to that organization for fitting or for selling my coffee machines. Rather than this, again, rather than locking that customer, what I can do is whatever will be consumable or the amount, based on the amount of your consumable coffees and your machine, based on that, I can have the recurring revenue from that particular business. So that is again a consumable model. Next one is usage-based model. There are some companies which basically gives their servers on rent. So however, or based on the data or based on the use of your data or that server, based on that, they will charge you their prices and all. And last is temporary access model. Temporary access model, you can have different type of advertisement. Suppose right now, the trending TV program on Indian televisions is Ramayan and Mahabharat. So suppose today Ramayan is being watched by thousands of people, lakhs of people, and you can, based on that, your customer, whoever is your customer, you can show advertisement of your product through this Ramayan. So this is how based on a temporary access, whatever serials, whatever programs they are running, whatever capsules they have in between, you can take that capsule 10 seconds, 20 seconds, and here you can display your advertisements. This is how one more temporary access model could be there. So these are some of the different models of businesses or business models. And the diagram which probably you have seen for generating this business model just will summarize this business model into 9 different components. So these 9 different components will discuss this entire business model canvas. Be it any business, at the end of this, we are going to study a business model canvas of Zomato and Swiggy as well. So be it any kind of your business, maybe of any different, like it could be a franchise business model, it could be a shared service model, it could be a temporary service model, it can be anything, but you have to make sure that all these 9 components you have to understand before you generate or before you commercialize your own product. So to draw this is basically a business model canvas. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight and nine. So this is an overview of this business model canvas. So first thing which you identify is your customer. So here you have to write down who is your customer. So here, whatever details you know about customer, who is your customer? For example, student is your customer. For example, institutions are your customers. For example, patients, they are your customers. For example, parents, they are your customer. For example, industrialist, they are your customers. For example, say you are in business like entertainment. All the entire youth is your customer. So whatever customer segment you have to take it down. Whatever details you know, their age, their demographics, their geography, everything, you have to write it down here, right? Second is value. So here comes a value proposition. For this customer, what value you are providing? What value propositions you are providing? What services you are providing? What changes or which kind of problems of this customer you are solving? So this value proposition should be there. And this is where you have to identify USP of your own product or your startup, unique selling proposition. So here with this approach, you have to find out what value proposition you are basically giving or providing to this customer segment. Next is customer relationship. This is your customer relationship. Now, to attract this customer to give this particular value proposition, you need to create a relationship with that customer. Now, how will you create that relationship? So we have n number of channels where we can attract this customer through advertisement campaign, through marketing campaign, through leaflet, through press media, through advertisement. So this is how you have to connect this customer so that you can define or you can provide this value proposition to your customer. Next is all those channels. You have to bring in all those channels here. Maybe social media channels, maybe your press media channels. You have to come with all these channels. You have to enlist all these channels. For example, refer and earn. Refer and earn could be one of the channel of creating this customer for this value proposition, right? Next is your revenue. What are your revenue streams? So ideally, there are 2 types of revenue stream. One is primary revenue, second one is secondary revenue. We are going to discuss it in latter part whenever we are going to discuss the case study of Zomato and Paytm. So in revenue stream, what are your revenue streams? How your company is making profit, how your company is making business, how or what are those revenue streams through which you are commercializing your idea, you are commercializing your product, that should come here. Next is your key partners. So this is where you have to allot your key partners. Who could be my partner? Suppose, for example, I am the owner of Zomato. So for me, my key partners would be first my app developer, my website developer, all the restaurants, all the marketing channels. These are all my key partners, my investors, my stakeholders. All these are my key partners through which or because of whose contribution I am doing my own business. So key partners, you have to enlist all those partners. Some services you probably are outsourcing from some agencies or from freelancers, from individuals. So here you have to write down all those key partners. So key partners will be at this stage, at this component. Next is all the activities. What key activities you are doing to run your business? So marketing campaign can be one of the activity, selling one of the activity, advertisement one of the activity, manufacturing one of the activity, trading one of the activity, services or maintenance one of the activity. So you have to enlist all those key activities in this part. Next is key resources. Here you have to allot your resources. Resources, your assets, or for example, if you are manufacturing something, your resources should be your machines, your quality testing laboratory, your inventory, your raw material. All this will be your resource, which is in physical form, which is your asset, right? And last and most important is your cost. How much cost is involved in this entire operation? So this is cost versus revenue. For example, to do this entire activity per year, I have to bring in 10 lakh rupees. So 10 lakh rupees is the cost for all these activities, be it for key activities, be it for resources, be it for creating a value, be it for advertisement campaigns, whatever it is. So cost is basically your cost of all the operations. So here you have to clear cut or you have to identify what are those different streams in cost. So this is again cost versus revenue. If suppose per year my cost is 10 lakh rupees and at the end of the annual or at the end of year, I generate, say for example, 50 lakh rupees revenue from different streams. So that could be a cost versus revenue. So here, before you commercialize your product, make sure you have this entire business model canvas ready with you. This will help you to create your project report. This will help you to understand or to project your own revenue stream, your own projections or assumptions about your revenue stream and your scale up as well. So unless and until you create this, unless and until you go with market survey and market research, you cannot imagine scaling up your business, right? So this is how a business model canvas, BMC, it plays important role. You can just Google BMC, you can just Google business model canvas. Say business model canvas of Google is available on Google itself, so you can identify what are those different streams. Now last part, that is here we are going to discuss the case studies of Zomato, case studies of Swiggy. So the question would be how Zomato is earning or what is the revenue stream of Zomato. That's the question. Is anyone can answer this? What is the revenue stream of Zomato or Swiggy? How these food startups, eventually the blockbuster startups, they earn? I need your answer in comment. Let's make it interactive. We are at the end of this session so that we can create or we can get some more questions, more doubts from your end. So my question is how Zomato and Swiggy earns? What is the revenue stream of Zomato and Swiggy? Yes. So I guess there is a lag time between this video broadcasting and your comments. So still will wait for a few seconds. So can anyone answer what is the revenue model of Zomato and Swiggy? Okay. So I will not wait for the comments because there is a lag time between broadcasting and all. So now, okay, delivery charges. Okay, thanks Kaushik. Okay, some more inputs from your end. What is the revenue model of Zomato and Swiggy? how Zomato and Swiggy earns. Okay, let's okay, percentage on sale or others. Okay, thank you, Sonal ma'am. Okay, let's discuss this scenario. Let's discuss this case. Now, Zomato and Swiggy, let's understand their operations. For example, if I'm a customer, right now I have ordered a pav bhaji, two plates of pav bhaji, and it cost me around 200 rupees. Okay, now I have to pay 200 rupees to Zomato. Zomato, what he will do is, there for in case of Pune or in case of Mumbai, the revenue model or that sharing revenue model, revenue sharing stream for this particular delivery and ordering is 20 to 25%. So for example, consider 20%. So what Zomato will do is 20%, he will, okay, ties with multiple variety restaurants, percentage on orders. Okay, so for example, if I have paid 200 rupees to Zomato, out of 200 rupees, 20%, the 40 rupees will be the secondary revenue for Zomato. They will keep it as it is and they will pay 160 rupees to that hotel owner. But now here the cost also involves to deliver my item to from restaurant to my address. Right now in this scenario, consider the cost, the streams of the cost. Okay, database of customers. Now consider the cost of all these operations. First of all, their marketing campaigns, right? See, because right now all these food startups, they are unicorn startup, because they have got very heavy investors, they could afford this advertisement campaign. Even you can take an example of Byju's. Byju started in 2015, but from 2017 or 2018 onwards, we started looking Shah Rukh Khan as a brand ambassador of Byju's. How this could happen? Because they have these investors and they could afford these celebrities for their campaigns and all. So right now, all these Swiggy, Zomato, these are in negative cash flow. These are in negative cash flow. They are not yet profit making businesses. Right now, they are doing whatever businesses they are doing, they are just recovering their cost. So that 40 rupee cost, they are recovering for their cost structure, which is marketing campaign, which is the salary of that delivery boy, which is probably the cost which is involved in restaurant tire. But at the end of this, this delivery charges could not be the primary revenue stream of these food startups. The primary revenue stream, or how these food startups are going to earn money, they have not started yet. And that's the reason right now they are in negative cash flow. Their primary revenue stream is consulting. Understand one thing, they are right now collecting data. Mr. Rajendra Shinde sir, he correctly said, they are right now collecting your data. They are right now collecting your food habits. They are right now looking at which restaurant has that five-star category customer, which customer is basically, right now I have some 20 different menus on my menu card, which is my best sellable item at the which center or which corner of my particular city. So this entire data right now I have on my application. So at the end of, say, by 2021, they could start their consulting business. For example, if suppose I wish to start a hotel or a restaurant on highway, so the best consultant for me is the companies like Zomato and Swiggy, which right now has ready data analytics of all my customers' food habits. So based on these food habits, based on these data analytics, I can then think, I can then rethink, I can then plan, I can then estimate, I can then assume whether to open the same restaurant in hotel in those highways or not. Again, I have some categories. Suppose I have a land near highway and right now I am confused whether to open a vegetarian restaurant, whether to open a Pizza Hut, whether to open a Punjabi dhaba, something like that. The best consultant to guide me here is Zomato, who ideally have that entire data, a proven data, where he can consult me, he can recommend me. Yes, you can go ahead with Punjabi Dhaba because these are the food habits in this particular location or during this highway. So this is how Zomato and Swiggy, even you can just see this case study on some different articles are there, different case studies are there based on this revenue streams of Zomato and Swiggy. The next question is how Paytm earns. If I can see some more comments on this question. So my next question is how Paytm earns. If anybody can answer, what is the revenue stream of Paytm? Let's understand the operations of Paytm right now. Initially when Paytm was there, Paytm had that, say for example, I have some 500 rupees on Paytm wallet, and if I want to transfer my amount from wallet to my bank account, there were some transaction fees. Say for example, 1.7% or 2.5%, something like that. So in that case, the transaction fee was there as their secondary revenue model, right? But even today, we do not have such kind of transaction fee in case of Paytm. That has been changed right now. So what is the revenue model of Paytm? How Paytm earns? Yes, if I can see in some comments, how Paytm earns per transaction? Okay. A commission based model, same just like Swiggy and Zomato or any other payment gateway or applications. Okay. So the primary revenue for Paytm or primary revenue for those all applications or for those all startups who have wallet in their system is parking interest. Parking interest is the primary revenue of Paytm. How it works? For example, consider we are, say for example, people here. Suppose consider a case where each one of us have at least 100 rupees on our wallet, right? Now, consider a case where everyone has at least 100 rupees on our wallet. So 10,000 is the total amount. I think all these starters for profit maximum, but with maximization. Yes, I'll come to that. So here the question is, for example, we do have whatever amount we have, say, for example, we have taken 100 rupees on each of us wallet. So for 100 of us, the amount of 10,000 rupees is there on Paytm wallet. If consider a case for next 2 days, we are not using this entire 10,000 amount, you can consider the interest of 10,000 amount, total amount of 10,000, which will be payable to Paytm, right? Now consider a case where you can see the channels or where you can see the number of downloads, where you can see the number of active users of Paytm. You can imagine how much amount each user have on their Paytm wallet, and then you can imagine what could be the smaller or smallest percentage of interest they are earning by using our money which is on wallet. So by November we had the same scenario, November 2019, where Paytm was doing good, Paytm was doing better comparatively with all those competitors. But after December 2019, what news we can see is there is 300% increase in the revenues of Paytm. 300% revenues have been increased during November to December thanks to FASTag. So FASTag, when government made it mandatory, you have to use your FASTags and all, everyone started purchasing this FASTag from even Paytm. Now, right now, in order to order this FASTag from Paytm, I have to keep a minimum balance of say 500 rupees. Right now, I am in complete lockdown. From the last 3 years, my car has been locked in my parking, but still I have some 1,000 to 2,000 rupees on my Paytm wallet, which I have reserved for FASTag only. Now you can consider a case where N number of FASTag users, they have their own money on their FASTag wallet, and what could be the interest on this particular wallet. So this is parking interest, and this is how Paytm earns. So that's the primary revenue of this Paytm. So this is how all these works. And yes, you rightly said that all these disruptive startups right now, rather than disrupting into an innovation, into a product, right now they are coming with disruptive business models. So even our Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji rightly said maybe 1 month back is the next era where we see startups as a next sunrise sector, where we see all these disruptions, disruption in product, disruption in innovation, and even disruption in business models. So this is it. I conclude this session here. But next, what we are doing is we are discussing some of your questions, some of your doubts, so that it will be helpful to you as well. But before I can see some of the questions, some of the comments, I extend my heartily thank to, or I'm extremely thankful to all our participants from different states, from different universities, from different institutions. They attended, they participated in this 3 days FDP on startup and entrepreneurship. We started this particular activity in order to have, or in order to create a startup ecosystem at your institutions as well. And that's the reason, even in the registration forms, we asked you what are, or what is the scenario at your campus, or how many student startups right now you are working with, or what is your entire scenario. So in case if you have any queries, in case if you wish to start, or if you wish to activate your startup center, your incubation center, be it at any campus, do tell us. We can recommend very good mentors. We can set up, or we can activate your startup centers by mutual coordination and by mutual association. But meanwhile, in case if we see any kind of questions that I could answer, please note down our website. It is www.opexindia.com, opex.india.com. Our YouTube channel, I hope everyone has subscribed. From 1st of June for Maharashtra, we are starting with our new campaign, which is Atmanirbhar Business. So let me tell you about Atmanirbhar Business. So Atmanirbhar Business is one of the campaign which we are running from 1st of June. And we actually invited some 14 different successful businessmen, successful entrepreneurs, so that they will come on the same channel, hashtag Opex India, on our channel, and they will share their inputs, their tips, their techniques, their strategies, so that we can come up with very good businesses, business development, and startups. So right from 1st June to 27th of June, we are running this campaign of Atmanirbhar Business, where we will have 14 different live webinar series on our YouTube channel. This is again a part of one of our venture, which is Plan B. So Plan B is our digital startup media, where you can have your own startup information, startup, all the startup resources you can get through this Plan B, which is a digital startup magazine. Even we will share you all the details of Atmanirbhar Business. This is again absolutely free. You can attend it. And this is, we are starting from 1st of June. So we will share you all the details related with Atmanirbhar Business as well as Plan B Digital Startup Media. Again, before concluding this, I'm thankful to all your principals, all your directors for sharing this information and appealing you all to participate in this. Last but not the least, I'm thankful to Mr. Sonavne sir for his all inputs in drafting, in designing the contents of this particular program. I'm thankful to Professor Dodmise sir as well, to whom we have shared this particular idea. And as like every time, whenever we share our ideas to create something in startups, he is the person who immediately get us into a green zone or a green signal, and through which, or with this association, we are working on 36 different student startups right now in NRIT incubation center. So right now we are mentoring all these 36 student startups from different institutions and universities. Okay, so after this, or probably during this particular session of mine, you have been received a feedback form and a link for your certification. So we request your genuine feedback on our entire 3 days FTP. As I said, why feedback is essential. So this will be again the same model: build, measure, and learn. So this is again will be helpful for us to learn. But in case if you have any questions, yes, could it be possible to plan FTP on different topics similar to this? Yes, Sonal ma'am, we can definitely arrange some more topics or some the level 2 of this particular FTP. This is basically a initial level or level 1 of this FTP where we had completely grounded all the topics. But there are again n number of strategies or techniques for startups. Even we have not covered anything about what is minimum viable product, what is pivot, or everything about lean startup. Again, I am appealing you all, if you could get this particular book, Lean Startup, please read this book. This will be a best resource for you in order to understand the entire journey of startups. Okay, so once again, I am thankful to all. I cannot see any of the questions right now, but in case if you have any suggestions, any remarks, any inputs, or anything which can relate to this 3 days topic, do let us know. Once again, I am thankful to all. Thank you so much. Namaste.